I am Dr. Kaushik, and today we are going to discuss about antihelminthics. Now, some of your last class were about antibacterial, and today we will discuss about the drugs that is active against helminths. Now, you know that helminths are macroscopic multicellular organism, and they have their own digestive system, excretory system, reproductive system, nervous system, and we can classify the helminths into mainly two parts, nematohelminths and platyhelminths. Nematohelminths are the helminths that have the tubular structure, and basically we call them ohms. And platyhelminths are flat structure. You have learned already about them in detail in your microbiology classes. And platyhelminths are of two types, trematodes and cystodes. So, before going into antihelminthics, let's very quickly check out their types. So, this is a picture from Goodman-Gilman, and you can see they have listed the leading cause of helminth infection. Now, there are some unique characteristics of helminth infection. First, they very rarely causes mortality. So, they can add to the morbidity of the patient, or if they cause anemia, there are some ohms that like Ascaris ohms, they can cause anemia, which may lead to mortality due to some comorbid conditions, but on itself they do not usually cause mortality, but they have very high amount of infection. So epidemiologically they are very, very prevalent. So you can see in billions, it is about 2 billion individual is suffering from Ascaris alone. So this is a huge number. It is a relatively old data. Still, in today's world also the prevalence will be almost similar. And that is why, for due to their such a huge amount of cases, that is high prevalence, the government, especially in the developing countries, they conduct different kind of programs. You will probably heard of the albendazole or DEC given to everybody in a particular endemic area. So that kind of program is conducted by our governments, especially in developing countries, to tackle this huge amount of helminth infection. So a very quick introduction about the nematodes. So they have long round bodies, and they are not segmented, they are unsegmented ohms. And these are the list: the Ascaris lambricoides, that is a round worm, Trichuris trichura, Enterobius vermicularis, Ankylostoma duodenal, Enterobius vermicularis, that is pinworm, and of course, last but not the least, Ucheridia bancrofti for filariasis. Now these are the important nematodes we have. And this is a list of platyhelminths, that is trematodes like cystosomiasis, chronochiasis, and here are cystodes. You have learned about cystodes in your probably 10 plus 2 level, the high secondary level, the pock tapeworm and weef tapeworm, especially Tinea solium, the pock tapeworm. And this is the cystode that causes neurocysticercosis, that is a very severe condition, you know. So this is one condition that can kill a patient. Otherwise, usually they can cause different kind of symptoms. Especially they can aggravate anemia in our developing countries. Otherwise, they do not kill patients. Here are the pictures. So roundworm, hookworm, you can see the filariasis and pinworm. This is tapeworm, whipworm, Fasciola hepatica, this is liver fluke, and onchosarcosis, and it causes river blindness. So this is not prevalent in India, but it is a very important disease when you look at the world. So let's start antihelminthic drugs. Now the antihelminthic drugs, basically anti means against and helminths means worms. So any drug which acts against worms are called antihelminthic. Very easy to understand. Now they can be of two types, vermicide and vermifuge. Vermicide are the drugs that kill worms directly, and vermifuge are the drugs that causes some problem with the parasitic movement, the movement of the helminths, and the helminths get lose their grip in the intestinal mucosa, and gradually they are expelled by the peristaltic movement of intestine. So basically you can think about it is like to some extent like bactericidal and bacteriostatic. So vermicide, that means that it directly kill the worms, and vermifuge, that will paralyze the worm and they will gradually expelled out of the intestine. Now ideal antihelminthics should have these properties. They should be orally active, effective in single dose. That is very important. Most of the helminth infection can be tackled only with only one dose. So that is good thing. If a antihelminthics have only a single dose eradication, then only we can use it for a mass program. It must be inexpensive. Again, a very important criteria for especially for developing countries. And wide safety of margin, that is with high toxicity for worm but lesser toxic to the host. So that these are the ideal characteristics that antihelminthics should have. So let's check out what are the available drugs. Now you can see there are some drugs that is written in bold, like this benzimidazoles and DEC, ivermectin and praziquantel. Now why I have made this bold, that means these are very important drugs as antihelminthics, and you must remember the all the important features of these drugs. Otherwise the drugs like pirantel, piperazine, levamisole or niclosamide that has been listed here, you have to know the names, but usually it is not very important clinically, and in for exam purpose also that is not very common drug. But you have to remember the name, of course. So let's start with the first drug, that is benzimidazole. Now benzimidazole, mainly it has two drugs, mebendazole and albendazole. And these are the mainstay of therapy for nematelmints. Okay, so basically they are mostly active against nematelmints. Now before I go into the specific of the drugs, I want to tell you that the helminths or nematodes especially have a peculiar structure which is very different from the mammals. They have in their peripheral nervous system both cholinergic as well as GABAergic innervation. In our body, mainly the muscles are supplied by cholinergic system, that is, you know that NN type of and nicotinic receptor are present in the musculature. But in case of worms, they have both GABAergic as well as nicotinic, that is NN type of cholinergic innervation in their musculature. So if we give some GABA agonist which does not cross blood-brain barrier, that will selectively inhibit the worm system, the worm. But that will not create any problem in the human host. So that is one property we can use for GABA. Okay, so let's move on. So mechanism of action of mebendazole or albendazole, the same mechanism of action. They inhibit the microtubule polymerization by binding to beta tubulin. Now this microtubule polymerization is very important for the nematodes. They in one side their microtubule is getting polymerized, in other side it get disintegrated. So basically there are turnovers of beta tubulin constantly occurring inside the nematodes. Now if you can inhibit this process, the beta tubulin, then this microtubule polymerization will be hampered. So ultimately that will cause some problem with the glucose metabolism. So a range of other biochemical changes are found in nematodes due to this beta tubulin inhibition, like inhibition of mitochondrial fumarate reductase, reduced glucose transport, very very important. They are very much dependent on beta tubulin for the glucose. So if you give mebendazole or albendazole, the beta tubulin formation will not happen in the worm and they cannot transport glucose. So ultimately what will happen, they will the ATP will get depleted and ohm cannot have any kind of energy. So basically these are hermicidal type of drug, okay, and uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation. So all these points will happen if you inhibit beta tubulin. So this is the mechanism of mebendazole as well as albendazole. Pharmacokinetics, minimal absorption, 75-90% is passed unabsorbed in the feces, excreted mainly in urine as inactive metabolite. Now there you, the special thing you have to remember about this antihelminthics, that the most of the helminths are present inside intestine. So you want your drug to be inside the intestine. So minimal absorption, that means the drug will remain in the intestine and kill the worms. Okay, so here we do not require absorption in most of the cases. So that is a difference from other antibacterial or any other kind of, most of the kind of drugs where we require absorption. Here we do not require absorption in most of the cases. There are special occasions where we require absorptions, like neurocysticercosis. Here the infestation is inside the neurons, that is inside the brain. Or suppose Echinococcus granulosus, the hydatid cyst that is present in the liver. So in that case also we require absorption. But here we do not require absorption in most of the cases because the worms are present inside the intestine. Adverse effects. Most of the anthelmintics has very minimal adverse effects. Only mild GI disturbances can happen, and any drug, you know, have propensity to cause allergic reaction. Some drugs cause more allergic reaction and some other drugs cause less allergic reactions, but almost all the drug has a propensity to cause allergic reactions, except there are some drugs like corticosteroids, or they can also have some adverse effects like allergic reactions, but mostly they are used as anti-allergic rather. Otherwise most of the drugs has allergic reactions, and this mebendazole or albendazole or any other anthelmintics are not an exception. Rarely granulocytopenia can occur and loss of hair and elevation of liver enzymes. These are rare, but most common are GIT disturbance like nausea, diarrhea, and diarrhea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and these are very minimal. Patient can easily tolerate that. And remember, most of the cases we require only single dose or very short duration, dose for short duration. So ultimately adverse effect is not a major problem for antihelminthics. Uses. Common indications, 100 milligram twice daily for 3 days. So 100 milligram twice daily for 3 days. This is the common indication. That means in most of the nematode infection we will use this dose. Enterobius vermicularis, 100 milligram single dose and repeat after 2 to 3 weeks. Now remember, in almost all the cases we use albendazole rather than mebendazole. Albendazole is the drug of choice in most cases, but this enterobius, here we can see that mebendazole is better than albendazole. So if examiner asks that what is the indication where mebendazole works better than albendazole, you should answer enterobius. And also you can use it in Trichinella spiralis also. Now moving on to albendazole. Now albendazole is a congener of mebendazole. It is again an benzimidazole. The mechanism of action is same. That means it inhibits beta tubulin polymerization, so that glucose transport is inhibited, and mitochondrial fumarate reductase enzyme is inhibited. So this is the again the same mechanism of action. Pharmacokinetics, moderate to inconsistent oral absorption. Now fatty meal enhances absorption. This is a very, very important point. I should mark it. Why this is very important? Because this is one condition where you can alter the target area depending upon the food. If you want albendazole to work in the intestine, that means in most common ascaris and other kind of all the nematodes infection, you give it with the empty stomach. So the absorption will be minimal, drug will remain in the intestine and it will exert its action. But if you giving albendazole for indication which requires systemic absorption, like Echinococcus granulosus, that means hydatid disease, or neurocysticercosis, or any other systemic condition, then you have to give it with fatty meal. So basically, you change the food, the drug, and the drug with its relation with food, and you can control its action, the site of action. So that is very important. And this is one example. If your examiner asks that, mention one drug where you can alter its site of action with food, then your answer should be albendazole. Now it is absorbed. When it is absorbed, it forms a sulfoxide metabolite which is active, and it is active and penetrates brain with t-half of 8 to 9 years, and it is basis of tissue anthelmintic action. So for intestinal worm, again, given in empty stomach, and for tissue action with fatty meal. So albendazole is a very important drug, and this is the mainstay of therapy against nematodes. So use of albendazole is very important. It is available as 400 milligram tablet, and for children it is available as 200 milligram per 5 ml suspension. Normal dosing, it is single dose 400 milligram. It can be repeated after 14 days if required. So you give 400 milligram of albendazole, and after 2 weeks you can repeat the same to ensure the eradication of helminth infection. Tapeworm 400 milligram for 3 days. Neurocysticercosis, treatment of choice is albendazole 400 milligram twice daily for 8 to 30 days. Now neurocysticercosis management is a tricky one, because all the neurocysticercosis case we do not treat with albendazole. There is another drug you will learn later in this part of this seminar. That praziquantel is also active against neurocysticercosis. This is the main drug against platyhelminthes. So it is also effective against tinea solium. But the praziquantel or albendazole, it is not given to all the patients of neurocysticercosis, because if you kill the tinea solium or the cyst, that can create a tissue reaction locally, and that can actually cause many more problem rather than alive. So many times physician can opt for corticosteroid to decrease the reaction and decrease the local inflammation, and give a very long term anti-epileptic. So neurocysticercosis patients present with epilepsy, a seizure, and anti-epileptics is the mainstay of therapy. Patient may need to give anti-epileptic for prolonged period, and some patients, if the physician thinks, only those patients are treated with albendazole or praziquantel, mainly albendazole. Sometimes corticosteroid is also given to minimize the tissue reaction. So you can think, if inside the brain something is causing inflammation and damaging the brain, it is better to suppress the inflammation first. So this is the main approach of treating neurocysticercosis. Next indication is hydatid disease, that is Echinococcus. 400 milligram BD for 1 to 6 months. So very long term treatment is required in this case. Filariasis with DEC and ivermectin. Both of the drug will be discussed in the latter part of this class. So again, albendazole can be used with DEC or ivermectin. And remember, it is used in mass program because it is cheap, because it is safe, because it is effective. So both the things we discussed in the first slide of anthelmintic drugs are satisfied by albendazole. It is cheap drug, it is effective drug, and it is safe drug. And the adverse effect is similar with as mebendazole. It causes nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and nothing special. It is very well tolerated actually. Next drug is pyrantel pamoate. It activates the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. Now you will see that some antihelminthics actually increases the activation or increases the activity of cholinergic receptor. So what will happen? There will be persistent depolarization. So you can see here persistent depolarization. If cholinergic receptors are active, then what will happen? Persistent depolarization. And if GABAergic system is activated, there will be hyperpolarization. So pyrantel pamoate, what it causes? It causes persistent depolarization. So ultimately it will lead spastic paralysis of the worm, and worms will be expelled gradually by peristaltic movement. Now piperazine is a drug which causes flaccid paralysis, that is antagonizing action. So if you give them both, actually they will counteract each other, antagonizing action. So you never combine them together. Basically, we very rarely combine these antihelminthics. Usually one drug is sufficient. If it is not treated, you may have to repeat or you may have to change the drug. But rarely we have to combine the drugs. In some cases we may require, like in filaria or in some cases, but otherwise we do not require multiple drugs. And the spastic paralysis and flaccid paralysis, you do not combine these two drugs because they have antagonizing action. Pharmacokinetics, only 10 to 15% is absorbed. Again, you do not require absorption for the therapy of helminths. ADR is very common, very uncommon, and this is the dose you can see. But just remember that pyrantel pamoate activates nicotinic receptor and it causes spastic paralysis. Otherwise, it is not a very important drug clinically. Again, piperazine, it is not very important drug, another drug which is not very much used, but yes, you have to remember the name and its action. Of course, it has GABA agonistic action, so it causes flaccid paralysis. That's the opposite of the before, the pyrantel pamoate. So it causes flaccid paralysis and ultimately that worms are expelled. ADR is, again, it is very well tolerated. Use roundworm infestation. Roundworm infestation, remember, it is safe in pregnants. Actually, albendazole is also safe in pregnants. In pregnancy, we can use albendazole, but it is better to avoid in the first trimester. You can give it in second and third trimester, but it is better to avoid in first trimester. DEC, this is very important drug. DEC, we very much use it in our national programs against filaria. So treatment of filariasis and Loa-Loa. Loa-Loa is not very common in our country, but it can be used. Pharmacokinetics, it is rapidly absorbed from GI tract because we require tissue action for that. Remember, filariasis, microfilaria, it is present inside the lymphatics. Okay, so you require systemic absorption. So it is rapidly absorbed from gut and it is excreted in urine unchanged. Mechanism action, it mainly causes alteration of microfilarial membrane, and so that it can be phagocytosed by tissue monocytes. Okay, so this is the main mechanism. It also compromises intracellular processing and transport of certain macromolecules to the plasma membrane. So major mechanism is alteration of microfilarial membrane so that immune system can attack this. But remember, it can kill microfilaria and it can have some action against the adult worm also. So filariasis is caused by Eucheria bancrofti. It has some effect against adult worm also. But remember, the filariasis, which is associated with a huge edema. So you have, I think you have seen the elephantiasis, that legs are very much swollen due to lymphatic obstruction. If you treat those patients with DEC, remember, the condition will not be reversed because the damage is irreversible. But what it will cause, it can kill the adult worm, and as it is very much active against microfilaria, that will decrease the transmission of the disease. So that is important. But remember, elephantiasis condition will not get reversed. Okay. Another indication is tropical eosinophilia. Again, DEC can be used. Febrile condition, rash, pruritus, enlargement of lymph nodes. This is the adverse effects. And nowadays, DEC is not used for OncoSarca. Previously, it was used for OncoSarca also, but nowadays, ivermectin is the drug of choice for OncoSarca. But DEC is still very useful drug to treat for treatment of filariasis, and it is part of our national program. Next is livamizole. Now, livamizole, it is again another drug that causes tonic paralysis of worm and inhibition of fumarate reductase system. But it is actually, it has antihelminthic action, of course, but it is mostly used nowadays as an anti, and not anti, it is immunomodulator. So we will discuss immunomodulator in detail in the immunomodulator lecture class. But remember, it is an immunomodulator. So basically, it restores the depressed T cell function. If somehow the T cell function, the part of immunity, the T cell function is depressed, then we can use livamizole to act as immunostimulant. Okay. So this is one way. It can be used in vitiligo. It has been also tried to prevent the recurrence of colorectal cancer. So these are the important use. As antihelminthic, we do not use nowadays because we have better antihelminthic like albendazole. Ivermectin, this is another important drug. Remember, the important drugs are albendazole, mebendazole, ivermectin, DEC, praziquantel. These are the main five drugs that you have to know in detail. So ivermectin, it is obtained from a fungus. You can see the name, Streptomyces abermetalis. And I think you have probably heard about ivermectin when we discussed about scabies. So you can see we have, it has anti-scabicide action, it is scabicidal, and it is active against head lice also, that is pediculosis, and Ascaris, against Ascaris it is also effective, and OncoSarca volvulus. Mechanism action, it acts by special type of glutamate-gated chloride channel. So again, it is activating, it is hyperpolarizing, so it causes hyperpolarization of membrane, but it is not through GABA, it is through a glutamate-gated chloride channel, which is found only in invertebrates. We humans do not have this kind of channels. So we have only GABA-gated chloride channel, which is GABA-mediated, but nematodes have glutamate-gated chloride channel also. It acts by this channel, so it activates that channel that causes hyperpolarization. And remember, ivermectin is also showing some promising effect against coronavirus, COVID-19, but it is not tried in humans. It is only some in vitro study. One in vitro study has shown that it is acting very good as anti-COVID-19 drug, but only in vitro. Human trials has not tried yet. And you can Google it if you want. So ivermectin, it is very important drug for scabies, for head lice, and for OncoSarca volvulus. Pharmacokinetics, against it require tissue action, so you have to have the absorption. Dose 3 or 6 milligram tablet, usually 0.2 milligram per kg, single dose for strong hyaluronidases, replaced in DEC and OncoSarca volvulus by WHO. Now that was the thing I was talking about. Previously, DEC was the drug of choice for OncoSarca. Now it is ivermectin. So ivermectin use again, number 1 scabies, number 2 pediculosis, number 3 Ascaris, and OncoSarca, and strong hyaluronidases also. Strong hyaluronidases. So you can see this is the dose here, strong hyaluronidases. And in filaria, along with albendazole, it can be used. Adverse effect, again, it is very less. Pruritus, nausea, and sometimes ECG changes can be caused by ivermectin. Niclosamide, it is effective against tapeworm. Now, until now, we were discussing about mainly nematelmints. Next two slides, probably. Yes. Yes, next two slides. These two drugs are effective against platyhelmints, that is niclosamide and praziquantel. Niclosamide, it is effective against mainly Tinea solium and Tinea saginata, but we do not use this drug much because praziquantel is much better drug. but it can be given in pregnancy. Inhibition of oxidative phosphorylation is the main mechanism of action. But you can see this problem with triniasolium is that dangerous visceral cysticercosis can occur. So it can actually aggravate the condition. So that is why we do not prefer niclosamide. You just remember the name. Praziquantel. This is the most important drug when we talk about the drugs against trematodes and cystodes, that is platyhelminthes. It is not active against nematodes. Mechanism, at low concentration, it causes release of intracellular calcium from the intracellular stores. So the calcium that is stored inside the cells of cystodes or trematodes, there it causes release of calcium, and that causes spastic paralysis of cystodes and trematodes. At slightly higher concentration, it causes tegumental damage and exposes a number of tegumental antigen. And as soon as this antigen is there, the immunity can sense it and attack against it. So remember, at low concentration, it causes spastic paralysis. At higher concentration, it causes direct damage to the tegumental antigen. So the antigens are exposed and immune system can kill the organism. Pharmacokinetics, it is rapidly absorbed and enhanced by food. High fast-pass metabolism. Phenytoin, carbamazepine and steroid reduce metabolism. Can induce metabolism, failure of therapy. That is very important when you think about neurocysticercosis. That is why praziquantel is effective against neurocysticercosis. Still, we do not use it. Mainly because you have to give some other anti-epileptic along with that, because the main symptom is epilepsy or seizure. So if you give phenytoin and carbamazepine, that will induce praziquantel's metabolism. So the efficacy of praziquantel will decrease. And you also have to give steroid to the patient to reduce the local inflammation inside the brain. That will also reduce the praziquantel concentration or efficacy. So taken together, you have to give two drugs which is very important for neurocysticercosis. That is one anti-epileptic and one steroid. Both the drugs has drug-drug interaction with praziquantel. So that is why for neurocysticercosis, praziquantel, although it is active, still we do not use it. We use albendazole because of these drug-drug interactions. Adverse drug action, bitter in taste, produce nausea. Basically, these are very less. Adverse drug action, total anti-helminthic chapter, adverse drug action is not that much important. Use available as 500 and 600 milligram tablets. First line of drug in all tapeworms except neurocysticercosis. And first line of drugs against all cystosome infestations except fasciola hepatica. So all the cystodes and nematodes are treated by this infection. So this is the ultimate slide you have to remember. So remember, albendazole is drug of choice for all nematodes except enterobiasis, where I told you that mebendazole is more active than albendazole. So enterobiasis infection, you should treat with mebendazole. Ucheraria and Brugia malai, that is the drug of choice is DEC. Oncosarca and Strongyloides, ivermectin. Dracunculus, metronidazole. Except this, all the nematodes infection are treated with albendazole. And praziquantel is drug of choice for all trematodes except fasciola hepatica, where bithionyl is the drug of choice, bithionol, and hydatid disease, that is echinococcus, that is treated with albendazole. And neurocysticercosis is also treated with albendazole. Now this is the thing you have to remember when treating helminth infection. So in a nutshell, we learned about different kind of helminths and how we can treat it. The mechanism of action of the drugs are mainly two types, vermicidal or vermifuge. The main important drug, albendazole and mebendazole, they act by inhibition of beta tubulin polymerization, which ultimately leads to hampering glucose transport and ATP generation. The other drugs mainly act either by spastic paralysis like pyrantel pamoate and levamisole. these cause drugs activates nicotinergic system and they cause spastic paralysis. The last drug, the praziquantel, it also causes spastic paralysis, but some separate mechanism. It is in case of platyhelminthes, and it causes intracellular release of calcium stores. So this is the drug that causes spastic paralysis. Other drugs like piperazine, ivermectin, this drug causes flaccid paralysis by either activating GABA mediated chloride channel or glutamate mediated chloride channel. Glutamate mediated chloride channel is activated by ivermectin. There are other drugs, that is DEC, which acts by damaging the mitochondrial membrane. So these are the mechanism of action. Most of the drugs require intestinal action, so you require less absorption, but you can alter their site of action of albendazole when you give it with fatty meal. The drugs like DEC and ivermectin, they also require systemic absorption. Otherwise, most of the drugs does not require systemic absorption. Praziquantel requires systemic absorption. Neurocysticercosis management, remember, it depends upon the patient and the physician. So if physician thinks he will try to kill the organism, he can use albendazole and rarely praziquantel. But depending upon the patient, he may opt for only antiepileptic and corticosteroid therapy, that is symptomatic management. So this was the antihelminthic class. Hope you enjoyed it. And okay, goodbye. Thank you.